great to be worshiping at this time, and as this song was just saying, we invite all of us as we come to bring ourselves together, but most of all, bring ourselves to the Lord, who is ever present with us right where you are. He is here in this fellowship hall, but he's right there with you wherever you are. And I want to invite us to take our souls as God is ever present. And as we've been reading through the Psalms, he's so ready to move in our lives if we will open ourselves to him. So I just want to invite us to remember that as we come to this time, that we come with all that we are going through. We don't just check it out and forget about it. We bring all that is on our hearts. We bring it to the Lord and know that God is able to meet us and move powerfully in us and through us. So I'm going to just invite us to lift up this song. This is a move.
Mountains are still being strongholds are still being loosed. God, we believe it. Yes, we can see that wonders are still what you do. Yes, we
next song is an oldie but a goodie.
Savior, he can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save. Conquered the grave.
meets us and weeps with us, but you are the God that conquered the grave. So Lord, we invite you to come and continue to minister to us. Give us faith. Give us trust. Help us run to you. Help us open ourselves to you and invite your life-giving word to speak to us today. In your holy and precious name. Do you want to share a few announcements of things that we're doing that we can gather together and continue to journey together? We do want to invite, just say hello to anybody that's new. Want to say welcome. We are a community that does meet in person in smaller gatherings. We are not meeting in a larger worship at this time, but we do meet in smaller gatherings. So please direct message us and find out different ways that we are gathering. We believe that we have a God that desires to walk with us every day, not just on Sundays, but every day, that he desires there to be with us wherever we are throughout the day and invites us to walk together during the week and to look out for people who are in need, to walk alongside these individuals. That's what our whole church is built on. Our community is built on this heart of God to be with us, desiring to walk with us and with one another. And so these are the different things that we are doing. We are in the midst of a Psalms reading schedule or a series, and we do have a reading schedule where we finish the whole Psalms, all 150 Psalms during this season. But and if you haven't started with us, feel free to just join wherever you are. We can send you right online. We'll send you the schedule. Just pick up where you are. If you can catch up on the previous ones, that's great. But just join us as we journey through the hearts and the prayers and the Psalms together. Other things that we're doing, we are having a Wednesday night barbecue in the larger church here at Aldersgate on the first and third Wednesdays at 6 o'clock. It's a wonderful meal. There are grilled hot dogs and hamburgers, all the fixings, and there's ice cream at the end as well. It's like $5 a person, $20 for a family. It's a wonderful time to just gather, to fellowship and be together. We're also, as a Connect family, joining on a picnic in the park on August 7th. Okay, August 7th, it's a Saturday. It's a park in Irvine. We did this before. It was a wonderful way to just gather together, hang out, have some meaningful conversations. It's 11 a.m. to 2 p.m., August 7th. And so let us know if you're interested. We'll send you the information regarding the exact park that we're at. Okay. Last but not least, and Pastor Tim is going to talk about this a little bit more, during this whole pandemic, it has been tough for many of us. And so many of our hearts, if we're honest, are grieving different losses. Loss of loved ones, loss of cherished activities, loss of capabilities in certain ways. And so there is a lot of grief that is on our hearts during this season. And one thing that I shared with our church family recently is, we say so nobody walks alone, how important it is that we do not grieve. So I want to invite us to grieve together as a church family. And this is one way that we are going to do it. On Saturday, we are going to open a space from 1 to 5 p.m. For you to sign up for a half-hour slot, for you to simply come to the sanctuary or join us online. We will have either one. And you will have somebody there to hear your heart and pray for you so that we might grieve together. And once again, Pastor Tim will share more about this at the end of his message. But let's open our hearts to all that God is doing, God's presence. And let's open ourselves to God's life-giving word.
So far from my cries of anguish. My God, I cry out have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls surround me, strong bulls of Bashan encircle me, roaring lions that tear their prey open, their mouths wide against me. I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart has turned to wax, and it has melted within me. My mouth is dried up like a pot shred, and my tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. Dogs surround me, a pack of villains encircle me. They pierce my hands and my feet. All my bones are on display. People stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment. But you, Lord, do not be far from me. You are my strength. Come quickly to help me. Deliver me from the sword, my precious life from the power of the dogs. Rescue me from the mouth of the lions. Save me from the horns of the wild oxen. I will declare your name to my people in the assembly. I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you descendants of Jacob, honor him. Revere him, all you descendants of Israel. For he has not despised or scorned the suffering of the afflicted one. He has not hidden his face from him, but has listened to his cry for help. From you comes the theme of my praise in the great assembly. Before those who fear you, I will fulfill my vows. The poor will eat and be satisfied. Those who seek the Lord will praise him. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth will remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations will bow down before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. All the rich of the earth will feast and worship, and all who go down to the dust will kneel before him, those who cannot keep themselves alive. Prosperity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord. They will proclaim his righteousness, declaring to a people yet unborn, he has done it. The word of God for the people.
All right, well, good morning. Can we give a shout out to Miss Amber Rain for reading all of Psalm 22? I told her we got a long scripture this morning, but this is Psalm 22, and we wanted you to hear all of it. And during this series, we're in this series on Psalms called Prayers of Our Heart, and we're reading through the Psalms in 30 days, as Pastor Ken was sharing, using the Book of Common Prayer. And I wanted to ask you, how's it going for those of you who have been joining us in this? I'd invite you just to share in the comments. Have there been particular words or themes that have struck you, particular passages that have spoken to your heart? So if you're just hearing about this now, great time to join us. We are going to be doing this over 30 days. And I want to let you know that we're reading probably like 4 to 5 psalms a day. There's a morning reading and an evening reading. And I know talking to Cindy, it's just, that's a lot. And she's just, she would rather kind of just sit down and really just sit deeply in one psalm. And so as you look at our schedule, I invite you to just to be in the Word and to allow that to be a gift to guide you into that. And however that is most meaningful for you, just to be together journeying through the Psalms. That's what we're doing in this 30 days together. So, but I do thank Amber for reading all of Psalm 22. And last week, actually, Amber forwarded me a text that said this. We tend to shy away from mourning and dancing. Too afraid to cry, too shy to dance. Avoiding pain, but also true joy. While we live in a world subject to the evil one, we belong to God. Let us mourn and let us dance. Let us weep and let us laugh. That's what the Psalms invite us to do. To express our deepest emotions. To pray our deepest feelings. To bring them before God and process them there. Now, personally, that's hard for me to do. I will dance every now and then if TikTok is involved. But I rarely, if ever, cry. I'm not, in that way, a super emotionally expressive person. If anything, I have a harder time just getting in touch with my feelings. So praying prayers of the heart is a stretch for me. It's an area in which I need to grow, which is why I really appreciate this series. In this series on the Psalms, each week we are praying through a deep felt emotion. We're inviting the Psalms to teach us how to pray, to give us the language of prayer. And today, our focus is on praying our tears, praying through our pain and grief. Today, we want to unpack what it means to pray prayers of lament. In some sense, we want to rediscover the ancient practice of lamentation. I don't think we talk a lot about lament or lamentation. But the Psalms overall, they are a collection of 150 prayers. And these prayers can be broken down into different categories, different types of prayers. And one of these categories is lamentations, prayers of lament, prayers of tears. And what's interesting is that there are more lamentations than any other kind of prayer in the Psalms. The book of Psalms is full of psalms of tears. Prayers in which the psalmist cries out, God, why is this happening? God, where are you? My God, why have you forsaken me? As Tim Mackey points out, prayers of lament are common, and they're such a part of the Psalms because they spring out of an address, what he calls the great contradiction. The great contradiction that each of us will face at some point in our life, the great contradiction that causes some of us to question our faith. And here's the contradiction. On the one hand, God is good and wants what is good for us. And on the other hand, life is full of tragedy and pain. And how do these two go together? How do we make sense of this? How do we resolve this contradiction? Well, for the most part, the Psalms don't give us a theological explanation. They don't try to solve this question intellectually. Instead, they invite us to pray through. They invite us to pray through our unanswered questions, to pray through our grief and pain. They invite us to pray prayers of lament. So I just wonder for you, I wonder if it surprises any of you that the most common kind of prayer in the Psalms are prayers of lament. Any of you think the most common kind of prayer would be prayers of thanksgiving? prayers that declare life is good, that declare God is good? I think some of us probably expect that, but that's not what we find in the Psalms. We find a lot of prayers that are prayers of tears. And I think this is significant because it tells us something about what to expect in life and what to expect as disciples of Jesus in life. And I want to say a brief word about these expectations, and in particular to those, the youth and young adults that are worshiping with us. See, personally, I think it's really helpful to know what to expect when I'm heading into something. Like, I really want to know what I'm getting into. So for example, if I'm going to run a marathon, if I decide to run a marathon, I don't want to be told, hey, you got this, no problem. Just stay positive, you'll be fine. I'd much rather hear someone say to me, if you're going to run a marathon, just know it's really likely that around the 20-mile mark, you're going to hit a wall, and your muscles are going to be screaming. But if you give yourself just a quick energy boost and press on, you can get through it. It's helpful to know what to expect. In a marathon, expect to hit a wall. In following Jesus, expect to experience suffering. Expect tears. Expect tears. Now, I share this because, in part, there is a theology out there that goes something like this. If I do what is right, then God will protect me from pain and grief. If I live a life of faith, there will be less tears in my life. But as Timothy Keller points out, in some ways the exact opposite is true. If I live a life of faith, there will be more tears in my life. Why? Why would that be true? Well, one reason is because God's Spirit will soften my heart. It's the imagery that Scripture uses of God taking a heart that is hard and making it softer. That means that God's Spirit will make my heart more open to others, more vulnerable, more touchable, more aware of the sufferings of others. And God's Spirit will expand my heart. My world will get bigger if I follow Jesus. I will be moved by and feel the pain of folks living on the street or in their car, of kids who are caught in human trafficking, of refugees, of folks who felt the sting of racism, of orphans in Rwanda. We think of all the different areas where even as a church, we're invested. The closer I follow Jesus, the more I'm moved by the pain and suffering of our world. As Romans 12 puts it, I will rejoice with those who rejoice, and I will weep with those who weep. I will rejoice and weep. I will cry and dance. Followers of Jesus experience more of both. Faith and tears go hand in hand. And we see this most clearly in Jesus. Jesus lived a life of perfect faith. Jesus obeyed God fully and wept deeply. He was known as a man of sorrow, acquainted with grief. And in his sorrows, Jesus prayed the Psalms of lament. He prayed these Psalms of tears. And this morning, as we look at Psalm 22, I want to do two things. First, I just want to reflect on what it means to lament. Because I don't think we talk a lot about that or do that a lot. What does it mean to lament? I want to do that first. And then I want to focus in on the significance that Jesus prayed this prayer of lament. The significance that on the cross, Jesus cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? But first, what does it mean to lament? And I want to touch on two aspects of this. Because this is something that our leadership team, even in Connect, we've talked quite a bit about. Because I do think in general, in church culture today, we don't give a lot of room and space for lamentation, for lament. So what does it mean to lament? First, to lament is to describe to God what is happening and how we feel about it. And for some of us, that's just not the way we pray. As Tim Mackey describes it, when hardship hits, for a lot of us, our default mode is to make requests. God, help me. God, help me. But when you look at Psalms of Lament, including Psalm 22, there are some requests, but these requests are only a small part of the prayer. That's what we see in Psalm 22, right? Just starting with the beginning. My God, why have you forsaken me? Not a request. Why are you so far from me? Not a request. I cry out, but you do not answer. The psalmist goes on, in you, our ancestors trusted in, and you delivered them. But I am a worm, I am scorned by everyone. Many bulls surround me, this metaphor of wild animals surrounding David. My heart is turned to wax, it is melted All my bones are on display. People stare, they gloat over me. They divide my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment. All this description, all of this prayer, finally, in verse 19, we get this string of requests. Lord, do not be far from me. Come quickly to help me. Deliver me from the sword. Rescue me. Save me. And then from verse 22 on, through the rest of the psalm, there isn't a single request. So out of 31 verses, there are three lines of request. And that's not how I usually pray. As Tim Mackey points out, our assumption is that God already knows what's happening, and God already knows how I feel. What I need to do is tell God what God needs to do. But Psalm 22 makes the exact opposite assumption. God already knows exactly what to do. Help me, rescue me, save me. The majority of this prayer is taken up describing what's happening to me and how I feel about it. That's the heart of biblical lament. To lament means to understand that God actually wants to hear from me how I'm doing. That God wants me to sit down and share how I'm processing all that's going on in my life and how I'm feeling about it. Once again, that's not how I tend to pray. But it is how I would want my children to communicate with me. If my son Daniel is sad or angry, I would want to hear his request, yes. But even more so, I want to hear him say, Dad, here's what happened to me. Let me tell you about it. I would want him to just share what was going on in his heart and mind. And that's what God wants to hear. To lament is to let God know what's wrong and how we feel about it. Secondly, and relatedly, that means that to lament is to draw close to God. I think some of us are uncomfortable with this kind of prayer because it might feel disrespectful. Like, you shouldn't talk that way to God. But lament is a reflection, not a rejection, of our relationship with God. Notice what David says here. My God, my God, why have you forsaken me? This is a deeply personal prayer. Why are you so far from saving me? So far from the words of my groaning? My God, I cry out by day, but you do not answer. By night, but I find no rest. Yes, David is railing against God. Yes, David is beating his fist against God's chest. But in doing so, he's drawing close to God. This prayer is deeply intimate. David says, God, you brought me out of the womb. You made me feel secure on my mother's breast. From birth, I was cast on you. From my mother's womb, you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one who can help me. I am poured out like water, and all of my bones are out of joint. My heart is turned to wax. It is melted within me. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. You lay me in the dust of death. This prayer is so intimate, so personal, I think it makes some of us uncomfortable. For some of us, it's like, that's not how I talk to God. As I was reflecting on Psalm 22, I was thinking, you know, if I journaled like this, if I wrote down prayers of lament like David did, I would be scared of folks finding my journal and reading it. Anyone else with me? All right, Sunday's with me. No, but seriously, it would just be like, wow, Pastor Jim's not doing well. I mean, this is King David, the greatest leader of Israel. This is his personal prayer. And it's so intimate. It's so real. It's so raw. It's so vulnerable. That's lament. And when we pray these prayers of lament, we're not rejecting God. We're actually drawn close to God. I recently read of a pastor who visited an orphanage in Russia as part of the process of pursuing adoption. And here's what stood out to him about this orphanage. The silence. The babies in the nursery were totally silent. They weren't crying. They weren't weeping and wailing. Why? Not because all of their needs for love had been met, but because they had learned that no one would respond. Crying out demonstrates a child's trust in the love of their caregiver. And crying out to God demonstrates our trust in God's love even when God is silent and doesn't respond. In lament, we cry out, God, where are you? God, don't you care? And the Psalms teach us that God welcomes this kind of praying. It's safe to pray to God like this. It's safe to pour out our tears to God. God can handle our honesty. To lament is to draw close to God, even when, especially when it feels like God is distant. Which brings us to Jesus praying Psalm 22. As Jesus hung on the cross, he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Jesus Christ, the Son of God, while hanging on the cross, took up David's lament, our lament, and he made it his own. This is significant because it tells us that Jesus has completed this psalm of lament even if we haven't. And here's what I mean by that. The first half of Psalm 22 is a cry for help. But the second half, starting in verse 22, It is a song of praise for this help. And Jesus experienced both halves of the psalm. Jesus cried out to be rescued, but he also ultimately experienced God's deliverance. Yes, Jesus died on the cross, but he also rose from the grave. And this gives us something to hold on to in our tears. We may never see the deliverance described in the second half of Psalm 22. But Jesus has. And he has done so in our place and on our behalf. See, his resurrection is a promise that our deliverance will come one day. His resurrection is a promise that the worst thing is never the last thing. It's a promise that weeping may last for the night, but ultimately, joy comes in the morning. And so I say this once again to the youth, the young adults that are worshiping with us. Here's what you can expect, according to Scripture. Here's what you can expect as a follower of Jesus. In following Jesus, expect tears. But know that tears are not the end of the story. Expect tears. No, the tears are not the end of the story. As Jürgen Moltmann writes, God weeps with us so that one day we may laugh with God. God weeps with us. That to me is the most striking aspect of Jesus crying out the psalm from the cross. As Christians, we believe that God suffers with us. That God understands our grief and pain, even if no one else around you can. God understands our grief and pain. That God knows what it's like to feel God forsaken. That's such a unique view. says this. The point of lament, it's not just that it's an outlet for our frustration, sorrow, loneliness, and inability to understand what's happening and why. The mystery of the biblical story is that God also laments. God was grieved to his heart, Genesis declares, over the violent wickedness of his human creatures. God was devastated when his own bride, the people of Israel, turned away from him. And when God came back to his people in person, in Jesus, he wept at the tomb of his friend. St. Paul speaks of the Holy Spirit groaning within us as we ourselves groan within the pain of the whole creation. The ancient doctrine of the Trinity teaches us to recognize the one God in the tears of Jesus and the anguish of the Spirit. God laments. God laments, and God invites us to lament. In the midst of this pandemic, in which over 610,000 Americans alone have died, our call as followers of Christ isn't to explain why this is happening. Our call is to lament even when we can't explain. Our call is to weep with others, even as God weeps with us. And in this series, our hope is not just that we study the Psalms, but that we pray the Psalms. And we invite you this week to pray prayers of lament. And that's one reason we're offering on Saturday this time to be prayed for. We want to pray with you. We want to pray for you. So we're offering this window Saturday to 1, from 1 to 5 p.m. Half-hour time slots. We invite you to direct message us or to call or email the Aldersgate Church office during the week. And just let us know the time that is best for you. Pastor Ken and Amber and I will be there. We're going to have folks available just to pray for you. Let us know the best time. We're inviting you to join us in the sanctuary if you'd like, but also to be prayed for online if that's what you would prefer. We're wanting to grow as a community in being people who grieve together so nobody walks alone. That's what the Psalms invite us to do. To pour out our heart to God. To do so together. I want to invite Amber to come back up and to just lead us in a time of prayer as we respond to this Psalm.
Children who've skinned our knees, telling us all about how we fell or how we were running and it was so much fun and then everything went wrong and now it just hurts. Just run to you like children who need your compassion and say, I know it's hard and let's clean it and let's get a band-aid and hold it. It does not fix the pain at all, but you are with us in it. God, I love that about you, that you just want to be in it. You want to know all the things. You want to hear about all of the wounds. You want to hear all of our anger, all of our rage, even if it is directed at you. And like Tim said, in that anger and beating on your chest, we are more physically close to you than we are crying by ourselves in a corner. God, teach us and let us experience that you truly are a God that will hold us tightly in our tantrums until we calm, who will wipe our tears away, and who will say, I know it hurts. And let us find the joy and the life and
true classic, Precious Lord, Take My Hand. And I just invite us to pour out our hearts to the Lord, and pour out our souls, and say, God, help me, take my hand. There might be something we just don't know how to get through right now. And we just say, Lord, help us get through. Precious Lord, take my hand.
Sunday in September, but until then, we still want to walk with each other. And I just want to let you know on behalf of our leadership that if at any point you would want someone to meet with you, and if even if Saturday doesn't work for you, please let us know. We would really be honored to just sit down and listen and to be in that together with you. So as you go into this week, know that God understands. That God invites us to be real and honest and authentic in our prayers. That God invites us even to pray our tears. And that God really wants us. who we are as we are. So let's walk in the freedom of the prayers with God this week. And as we do, may the love of God, the grace of Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be ours now.